Hello everyone. Bear with me. I just need to move Ben across because he crashed out and it's caused trouble. Let's move him back. How's that? Ah, it's looking good. Are we there? Oh, it's so close. And across a little bit more. I think it was where he started off. I shouldn't have moved him. Oh, a bit too far. Let's come back. Oh, one little more. It's got to be perfect. Otherwise, it will annoy me all evening. Let's try that. Oh, too far. No, it's good, I think. You could potentially go up a little bit, maybe. It's got one little notch. This is where it goes horribly wrong because it's impossible to go up one notch on this stupid thing.
This tells you a lot about Luke, viewers,
That'll
in
do.
case you were wondering.
I've got to watch the screen for the next like 2 or 3 hours or something. It'll drive me absolutely mental. I think we're sorted. In which case, good evening, everyone, and welcome to tonight's Boys from the Baltic Star. And it is Saturday night, which means it is the night when we play other games which aren't Traveller. And those really sharp-eyed of you may notice that tonight we're playing a game called Troika. And Ewan tonight is the golden barge driver, and I'll leave him to explain that in a minute what it means. It sounds like a sexy euphemism, but it's not. I promise you that.
Certainly isn't.
not here anyway. It might be elsewhere. But good evening, welcome. If it's your first time joining us, thank you. We really appreciate it. Thank you if you joined in, waiting for it to start, and then sat there for 10 minutes while Ben was failing with Roll 20 and falling out with it. If you're regular, of course, like spares, welcome. Thank you for being with us. We appreciate you. We always appreciate you. If it is your first time, please feel free to chat or to lurk. We're happy either way. Chat is quite friendly. If any of us aren't too busy in the game, we'll probably join in chat a bit. You can chat about what's going on, chat amongst yourselves. Totally up to you. If you want to lurk, we love lurkers. And so please feel free, lurkers, to lurk. And we won't call you out, won't shout you out. You know, we're just happy that you're here. If you like what we're doing tonight, it'll be somewhere probably between about 2 and 3 hours long. Feel free to drop in and out as you want. If it's not to your taste, that's absolutely cool. There's lots of other stuff to do in life. But thank you for giving us a try, I guess. There's a red sun there which you can click on and spend some points. I think there's some good stuff to spend points on if you want to. There is one thing there that if someone says something or we say something and you want to drink to that, there is a one credit thing which is like an agreement. I'll drink to that. We keep it as a one credit so that you can sort of agree and get involved without spending any money at all, really. But yeah, so do that. Spend points as you wish. Some interact with what's going on and change what we're doing, or make Ben pose, or make Ben like that one. It is Ben's. It's actually Ben's night off tonight. He's not GMing, so he will drink.
It's true. Will and have.
Just try and stop him. There should be one that makes you stop drinking for half an hour.
That would be a very, very cruel thing to do, especially on a hot night like this. You can develop a powerful thirst on a night like this.
But a powerful thirst. Sound like you're walking into a Western saloon or something. I've got a powerful thirst.
Powerful thirst.
So quickly, I'll introduce us, and then I'll hand over to you and who is leading us tonight. So my name is Luke. Hello, I'm in the bottom right-hand corner. I'm here. I'm hot and I'm steamy and I've got no socks on, so it must be warm. The guns are already out because it has been a very warm day. I play in this game. I play a guy called Carl Amfred. He is part of the Journeyman of the Guild of Sharp Corners, and he is a kind of a he's a tall, tightly wound, sharp cheekboned character. He's a nonchalant and quiet kind of man. Quite different to my dear friend who I'm playing with today and his character. It is the smartest man in any room. He lives his entire life in the Twin Peaks dream sequence. He is the milk tray man. And if you see him in town, he's normally standing down an alleyway drinking beer. Or he was
That
today.
was true today, certainly, yeah.
Thank you. It is Ben. Good evening, Ben. How are you?
I'm well, thank you. Yes, had a thoroughly nice little sort of side trip to the Hop Festival today, which was very, very much appreciated.
And it was a pleasure to see you there. I hope you enjoyed. Hope you enjoyed our presence as much as we enjoyed yours.
It was nice to bump into some friends. Yes, always appreciated.
Yes, and who do you play in this magical game of ours, Ben?
I play Lucy de Console, who is a woman of fine breeding and very little else, who is a bit brash, I suspect, a bit forward. She is a thaumaturgy type person, a thaumaturge, who has special magical powers and a jingling stick and a fez among her attributes.
I think you've listed her most important attributes there, I feel.
Mm.
Especially the jingling stick. She's a wonderful character, and it's a joy to play alongside her. And the two of us are playing alongside each other under the tutelage, the watchful eye and the wisdom of our beloved Ewan, the golden barge driver himself.
Ah, you fools.
Look, I've even put him up high, so he's looking down at us. Looking down upon us, see? There. Good evening, Ewan. How are you? It feels like it's been a long time since I've seen you.
Yeah, at least... actually, it's probably been like 6 hours, maybe. Yeah,
that's
a little bit longer.
It's a long time when it comes to not seeing you.
Thanks. Yeah, I'm doing well. Had a very nice time at Hop Festival, catching up with some friends that, you know, I don't get to see much of. Yes. Certainly not once or twice a week.
Yeah. Yeah. And some friends you get to see all too much of, yes.
Yeah. Well, I was alluding to something like that.
To be fair, you don't normally get to see us down a back alley. At least not in real life,
that's
anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true. Not in 3D down a dark alley.
So that was a little treat.
Indeed, it certainly was. Thanks for the stand.
Bunny Ewan.
Much appreciated. It's not even Easter anymore, Luke.
It's staying there. It came up for Easter, and I think Spez was one that liked it. Oh, the Spezel Socks liked it the most, so it stayed. And it'll stay forever. Put a little Santa hat on you for Christmas, maybe.
Yeah. I think that's fair.
Yeah.
Some fangs for maybe for Halloween.
I think my Photoshop skills can go to that.
That's a good idea, yeah. Yeah.
Right. What are we doing, Ewan? Where are we? What's going on? I don't understand anything, literally.
All questions I've been finding myself asking all week, frankly, about both Lissy and Carl. We're playing Troika. We left off in the city of Troika. Which is an interdimensional collection of Blancmange and Thistle hotels, grand and chromed, each with their own collection of Mandrill employees in red uniforms trimmed with gold, each with their own bar, rooms, roof, lift, stairs, and exits to the ports servicing the various modes of transportation used to leave Troika, onwards to the known spheres of the multiverse. It's a waypoint where any sensible traveller spends a night before continuing on to their destination, lest they face the uncertain dangers and consequences of direct travel. We join them there, and I think Luke put it best last week, something I don't say very often, when he coined the term star-crossed adventurers due to last week's technical issues. I think Ben might have been gone at that point. And so to briefly sum up what happened last week, two players, very different in dignity. Lucy with their take-no-prisoner approach and Carl doing his best to blend into the scenery. In fair Troika, where we lay our scene, from ancient, kind old lady, who they met amicably on the lift between floors 1 and 2, break to new lift shaft mutiny, where we ended on our way to the 6th floor, with Carl attempting to garrote the mandrel lift attendant. where mandrel blood makes mandrel hands unclean, mostly because the mandrel was attempting to soothe their pain in a bag of rotten passionesque fruits that they'd received off the shopkeep on level 3 after Lucy had inadvertently slammed their hand in the lift door. From forth the fatal tigers of these two tiger trainers, whom a pair of adventurers met either side of sharing a short part of their lift journey with said tigers between floors 4 and 5. A pair of star-crossed adventurers will hopefully keep their lives. And so we rejoin our adventurers on their way to the Feast of the Chili Arch on the hotel roof, which they had some questions about. They didn't find out a great deal, except there is no Chili Arch. That is just the way it has always been named, the way it will always be named. And that fireworks may or may not be involved, as well as some free food and beverages. The roof, which is directly above the sixth floor, as you would expect on a sixth floor hotel, but not always a given in Troika. The feast is a time when the normally distant hotels, each in their own identical dimensional space, become somewhat closer together, and some form of communication or visual degree of interconnectivity can be found. So you're both midway between floors 5 and 6. Inside the closed lift cage that is now moving with its thickly matted carpet, Lucy, now just about behind the tiny mandrel lift attendant, who's just spun round to turn and face Carl, and found them with their hands above their head, I believe, was somewhat what was happening, and a grot stretched in between. If you were both like to react immediately to that, because I think I called it pretty sharpish.
Yep.
At that point. Be my guest.
Well, if I understand correctly, he's just whirled to face Luke, so perhaps Carl should have the first reaction.
Carl is going to lower his arms as nonchalantly as possible, as if nothing had ever happened, nothing to see here. He knows he's been spotted, but he's overly nonchalant.
Just trying to pass it off.
Yeah, these things happen.
Okay, before we gather anything that happens further from that, is there anything that Lucy is doing?
Yeah, coffee, it turns out. yes, I think she's going to quite theatrically turn and examine the controls to the lift, as if that's what she was always intending to do from there.
Yes, which I think was pretty high up on your on your list of things to commandeer. It was definitely the lift. Okay, sure. Fine. You would do Carl first. Let's make a roll. Make a nonchalant roll.
Nonchalant roll.
Seeing as it's now canon, it's been mentioned at least 3 times so far in the stream, which I believe is not actually a skill in Troika, but it's one that we're going to make up.
Good.
Yes, we can make up skills in Troika, can't we?
Yes, and they can be really specific or they can be very vague. If you feel as though you'd want to add something to it or take something away if I'm too specific, just shout and we'll work something out.
Okay, so I have to roll, it's my skill, plus rank. I've got rank 0 because I don't have the nonchalant skill.
Yeah, and it's a roll under.
And it's 2 dice. Is it
on 2d6?
Is it equal to or less than, or has it got to be less than?
Equal to or less than.
Come on, I've got my low scoring dice tonight. I've got my Orbital Blues dice, which are my low scoring ones.
You mean your legal ones?
How very dare you?
How very dare I indeed?
Well, sadly, they've let me down, like all legal dice do, and it's an 8. Not nonchalant enough.
Yeah. I wouldn't say that that escalates the situation, but it certainly doesn't diffuse it as you would ideally hope. The mandrel sort of takes a step back from you towards Lucy, and is eyeing you up very cautiously at the present. Lucy, you've turned to face the...
Well, I sort of want to be sideways on, if you know what I mean. Sort of one shoulder pointing roughly towards the mandrel, one towards the controls, so that I can quite visibly be looking at the controls and waving my hand about over it in the hope that it will distract him. But I'm also able to kind of keep an eye on him out of the corner of my eye, hopefully.
Yeah, sure. Perfect. The mandrel, clearly quite concerned about how things have been going in this lift, very slowly continues to walk back. And unless Lucy decides to move or do anything else, then they will bump into them. You can see them coming slowly towards you. It's nothing major. They'll just walk backwards and you will be there.
I will allow the mandrel to literally bump into me and have to squeeze past a bit if he wants to get back to his controls.
Yeah, perfect. Carl, are you still playing it cool?
Yeah, always. Always playing it cool.
You still got the girl out, or is it? And you stored it away?
It's still put it down, so it's still in sort of in each hand, but now it's down, my hands are down by the side, so I guess it's across my crotch area, I guess, the wire, with my arms down by my side. And what I'll do is I'll look around and I'll say, Lucy, my friend, do you have the cheese? I've got the cheese cutter.
I do have it.
It is tradition for us, after all, to feast on cheese before a party.
I do have it, though. I mean, if I might say so, this is a relatively small space in which you might perhaps choose not to cut the cheese here.
Maybe cutting the cheese in a confined space is not the best thing to do.
Perhaps waiting until we're at the rooftop, something like that.
It's a good point. I was over-enthusiastic. I'm just so excited about the party.
I'm very excited about it as well. I'm wondering what we can see from the rooftop.
I do say it sounds beautiful, what they say you can see, with everything coming so close together, being able to see all the hotels. Impossibly close.
Yeah, I'm genuinely very excited about this. The Festival of Chili Arch is a new one to me, of course. And I'm told there will be fireworks. And later on, perhaps, some extreme violence. I'm very much looking forward to it.
It's always the part you look forward to the most, I feel.
I mean, it's like those kind of parties are made for me.
It's true. It's fortunate, really, I guess, that this trip has been at the start of the evening and not the end.
Oh, most definitely so, yes. Yes. For again, we're in a small space and wading hip deep through the blood of the innocent is not necessarily the way to comport oneself in a lift.
My dear mandrel, do you finish soon this evening or are you working at the end of the party?
First off, somebody make a lighter monkey check for me. You both can if you want.
That's a very
cheese indeed. Lighter monkey.
Lighter monkey. Okay. So what is a lighter monkey check?
That is basically going to be your skill at this point.
Okay. I rolled a 6. My skill is 6.
Oh, wonderful.
Oh, you're far more skillful than I. But my skill is a 5, and I rolled a 5.
Oh, wonderful.
Would you look at that? I tell you what, I got some advice from someone on Twitter this week, and we're gonna, or since our last game, a couple of weeks, and we're gonna house rule it that you both get Lighter Monkey at level 1.
Lighter Monkey level 1, excellent.
And you can put a little tick next to it as well.
Is it just monkeys, not other creatures?
No, just monkeys.
Apes.
I'd let you argue that.
Apes.
I mean, I was going to go with mandrill, but that seemed too specific.
Sure.
Mind you.
Whereas lying to monkeys is something much more generic. And
well, my thoughts exactly, Ben.
Yeah.
This is good. This is very good, Ben, considering all these hotels are manned by mandrills.
Well, exactly.
Very powerful skill.
This could be very useful.
It could be. They seem to believe you. They're not 100% convinced, but they certainly don't think that you were about to do what you were probably about to do to them. They're more concerned with the cheese and where the cheese is, and you can see them sniffing a little bit whilst trying to hide it under the normal, formal, you know, facade that they give off as part of their service in the lift. Whilst we're also there, Luke. In fact, no, don't even bother checking. As you look around at that point, you suddenly see another figure in the lift. Which you didn't see get on the lift. Very strange. But in front of you, you see a heavily armoured individual in fact, a brightly coloured suit of armour. Very spirally sort of multicoloured patterns across their breastplate and their... the rest of their armor, their helmet, and their I forget the word for them now, braces. Standing there with an equally colored lance in one hand.
My. Carl looks straight past this powerful creature and says to Lucy, you didn't slip anything into my drink in the bar, did you, Lucy? Just for jokes. It wouldn't be the first
unusual,
time.
Nothing unusual. Just the regular stuff.
Interesting. Okay. That would have been my first guess. Can you see what I see, Lucy?
Can I see what you see, Lucy? Can I, in fact, see brightly coloured knight?
You can see a brightly coloured knight, yeah. I wouldn't say you're necessarily... You probably put two and two together and assume that's what Carl sees as well, but that's for you to decide, I suppose.
I'm obviously going to say something like, well, clearly, I mean, imagine missing something that obvious.
Yeah, good point.
As you say this, the figure energetically waves to both of you and seems quite, you know, they've got some positive body language going on. Quite excited.
Okay. I suppose I will wave back. Why not?
Your waving back only encourages them, and they seem to get even more overwhelmed with excitement and almost drop their lance and start waving with both hands, but manage to hold on to it in the crook of an arm. And it's about that time that the ding goes, the familiar ding of the lift stopping. The outer doors open. The mandrel slides open the iron door, and in front of you, you see the hallway for the sixth floor. The mandrel looks at you, Carl, looks at the brightly coloured figure, and glares at Lucy, and gestures their hand out. On the side of the wall, just outside the lift, you can see an arrow that says the room numbers, listing the room numbers, pointing in that direction. And just below it, it says stairs to lift, and there's an arrow pointing along in that direction as well. Stairs to roof. Stairs to lift.
We're there already.
That would be a weird hotel.
Yeah.
Stairs to roof and some room numbers. Carl, you checked in, didn't you? Did you check in? Did you get a room? I can't remember.
Everything that I did happened off camera because I.
So it's up to you.
The first thing you saw was me walking over to the bar. Carl would have checked in. He knows that we're here for the night at least, and of course he wouldn't have made a big thing about it, but he knows the score, and he knows the importance of having a base of operations, if nothing else.
You would have, in fact, got the last room in the hotel at that point. It is very busy with the feast, which happens to be on the sixth floor. So your room is along here. Whether you've been in or not is entirely up to you. And you see a long corridor with rooms coming off either side. And at the very end, there is the equivalent of a highly gold-chromed looking fire door, but with some lovely detailing and of quite an ornate handle. You can sort of, but you cannot precisely pick out what it, how it's detailed from this end of the corridor. But that is in fact the door to the stairs. It's been pretty much the same on each floor. There's been a door at the end, that presumably leads to the stairs, which is your other option for getting here.
Yes. Lucy, I'd like to, just head to my room briefly first, if that's okay, just to check that all my belongings are stowed as I would like them to be.
I think that sounds like a brilliant plan. I'm genuinely curious to see what the rooms look like anyway, so yes, let's go. And with that in mind, she will step out of the lift. If there's any way she can sort of accidentally step on the foot of the mandrel on the way out, that would be appreciated.
Yeah, I would say that can. You probably don't even have to roll for that. That's well within your remit. It's up to you how hard.
Not with staggering violence, just enough to remind him that he's been a vicious, deceitful, lying piece of crap.
Whoa. As you do, the mandrel lets out a somewhat muffled howl, as if they're glad to see you leave and they're trying to get back into that work frame of mind, I suppose. But they definitely let out a howl, and as the doors shut behind you, you hear the iron cage slam inside when there's nobody else in there. And some more muffled noises of angry mandrel sounds.
What do angry mandrel sounds sound like?
I'm not going to do it, Luke.
Oh.
You can try and make me look as silly as you want.
Has the neon knight left the lift with us?
As you walk out, the neon heavily armoured knight with their lance comes bounding out after you. I'm trying to think of a good example now from a cartoon, but you know those annoyingly energetic and full of positivity kind of jumping leaps and looking from side to side. It's almost like that.
Right.
And they are indeed, they've come as far down the corridor as you have. They are following.
Okay.
Carl will go to the door. His door, and open it with the key or the card or whatever it is.
A key.
And offer Lucy in first. And then go in. Does the knight seem to want to come in, or is he happy outside?
It's weird. They followed you to the door. As you enter, they sort of look at both of you, almost expectantly, and they're not sure. They look a little bit unsure where to go.
Can I see his face, or is it, or their face, or is it in a helmet?
No, it's a full fronted helmet with some very thin slits across, where you can just about make out some eyes, some human looking eyes. As if, I mean, I'm tempted to make you roll for discern eyes, but
discern eyes. Oh, yeah, eye discernment.
Definitely sounds like a skill you need.
So Garl will turn, sort of give the character sort of a reassuring tap on the arm, you know, like a side tap, like a, and say, if you wish, you can stay outside the door and make yourself comfortable outside until we return. Feel free to sit or stand, however you wish. But I need a private conversation with my friend here.
Yeah, as you say that, they, I'm assuming this is in the doorway.
Yeah.
They beat their hand to their chest, turn around and slam their lance down on the floor. And they don't look as though they're at ease, but they are very much standing guard, I suppose it looks like.
Carl will close the door, make sure it's locked, before turning to Lucy. A friend of yours, Lucy?
Not even remotely. And you know, I have a habit of making close and lasting friendships in lifts. So it does seem strange that there is a literal silent knight following us around. And it does seem bizarre that, I mean, maybe it's just me, but I didn't actually see him get on the lift.
Oh, he was always there. Did you not see him?
No, but I was distracted by large cats and angry monkeys.
To be honest, I didn't see him at all. I don't know whether he was invisible and made himself visible when the time was right, or if pling in and out of existence. And if you could pling in and out of existence, why would you take a lift anyway?
I mean, you have a point. Why choose a lift of all places to pop into existence?
Exactly. I would have chosen the Feast of the Chilly Arch to be where I pinged into existence.
Yes. That makes perfect sense to me. Since you're going up there anyway, presumably. But he does seem to be, I mean, shepherding us around for some reason.
Maybe for the good or maybe for the bad. It can never hurt to have another pair of eyes watching your back when you're somewhere. If they can be trusted, that is.
Maybe it's just me, but I find it hard to trust people who just stand around being brightly coloured and never saying anything.
This is to do with that story you told me once about your childhood, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's understandable. Probably. It's understandable. Anyway, let's look around this room I've got. Please.
Yes.
Let's not spend too long, but let's see what's here. Anything exciting?
As you look around the room, it is a somewhat basic hotel room. You enter through the door. On your right-hand side, there is a bathroom, toilet facilities. You carry on the left-hand side. There is some quite ornate pictures on the wall, in frames. On the room then opens up to the right-hand side, and and there is a bed, a large single bed, a sofa up against the wall, and what looks to be some curtains drawn across the window. On the bed, you can see there is a there's a basket of what looks like an assortment of colourful boiled eggs.
Ah, oh, my favourites. Would you like a colourful boiled egg, Lucy?
I really would, actually. That sounds brilliant.
Pick a colour, any colour. And on...
Go ahead.
I will take and in fact devour a colourful boiled egg, please.
Perfect. You can pick whichever colour you wish.
If there is a blue one, I would like a blue one.
There is indeed. In fact, there's a selection of blue ones. There are there's like a sort of teal, there's a sky blue, there's a very rich navy blue.
Oh, sky blue, definitely. Yeah. That feels like the proper colour for an egg.
Wonderful. I'm just going to check something quickly.
He's checking the poison table.
How long does it take him to pass out? No, it's something much simpler than that I probably should have had to hand. At some point, you will gain some stamina. I'll look it up as we go on.
Okay.
Akin to eating provisions. Which should be pointed out. I'm not sure whether we've done the rules on provisions yet. You may only eat three provisions in a day, as per the rules. It's
does this in fact count as a provision, or is it potentially an extra provision?
This would count as a provision.
Okay.
If you wish to load up your pack with boiled eggs to add to your provisions, you may, although I'm not sure entirely how well they'll survive your journeys. I suppose that's up to you and how well you pack them.
Crumbled eggs in the bottom of your bag. Oh.
Mm. Yeah.
Well, I am tempted to say I don't think I'm going to transport significant numbers of eggs. However, I do apparently have a fez. So what I will do is take one egg and put it under my fez.
Wonderful. I would... you may add that to your inventory. I'm going to set a dangerous precedent here and say that whilst it will take up a slot on your inventory, it will be accessible at any point without having to roll for retrieving it, should you be in combat.
Excellent, thank you.
As it's an egg, anything else we'll have to take it as it comes, depending on how likely it is to bobble around. I'd say with an egg you can tip your head, take the fez off and pick it from out of the fez.
Well, I'm thinking a fez is a fairly stiff shape, but it also fits pretty tightly down on the top of the head, so it's quite a good storage space for an egg.
Yeah, that makes sense.
So Lucy, do you have a room or will one of us be on the sofa?
I'm afraid I didn't check into a room. We can, by all means, if you're comfortable with it, we can certainly share a bedroom. That's no problem for me. But I don't know if we'll be here long enough to actually require overnight stay.
Well, it's here if we need it, and we'll see. We'll see what.
Yes, it's very forward planning of you, actually.
You know me; I need to be. Ahead of the game, I have to plan things in advance, know what's going on, perfect planning and all that sort of stuff,
I'll leave it up to Lucy to decide whether she is aware of this, but As a, I think you said it was your first trip away.
Mm.
But Carl, you are more likely to be aware of this. It's quite common knowledge that when travelling to Troika, you seem to appear at the relevant hotel that is that can fulfil your needs for you. You know, if you need a room, it will take you to one with an empty room. If you're meeting someone, it will take you to one where that person is, regardless of whether there's a room or not. Troika has a way of providing what is needed.
Troika provides and Troika takes away.
Soon. with the basket of complimentary eggs, there was also a little note that just said, with compliments, the blancmange and thistle, and it's signed Hugo Provost Sawyer the First.
That's a name to conjure with.
It certainly is. If you want, you can both of you can make an awareness roll.
Okay.
I've got awareness.
In lieu of your journey through the hotel.
So that's a straight skill for me. I don't have any awareness as a special thing.
I've got awareness. This is rather good. Okay. And should be okay because it's six is my total and I've hit a five.
No, clearly my naivety as a traveller has not paid off on this occasion.
It's your first time.
Carl, your keen eyes and your sense of gathering what information you can from a room, I suppose, being of the background that you are, you notice that this is in fact this specific name was the name of the desk attendant. But every mandrel has had the same name badge but with a different number.
Okay. So they're all Hugo Provost Sawyers. Interesting. Thank you for the raid, Monkeytails. I hope your session went well.
Hey, Monkeytails.
Best thing, Monkeytails, is that we've just learned a skill. I now, in the game, I have a skill that I can lie to all apes and monkeys.
They both did, in fact.
Yeah. So now, if I ever need to lie to you guys, I get to roll with an additional plus one. Or whatever it is to my skill. So,
yes, we get a one for light a monkey. That is a new skill that we have.
Arasinka.
And probably very useful.
If it's specifically against infinite monkey tails, though, I'd make it a contested roll.
I think that would be fair, yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway, I hope you're all well. And thank you for joining us. It's much appreciated. And Ben mentioned what you were playing earlier and seemed to know a bit about it. So. Exciting. I hope it
Yes, I was very pleased to see you guys playing Twilight 2000. I think that looked a lot of fun. I'll have to catch your VOD when I get a chance, when I'm off this stream and sober enough to enjoy it.
So those of you that were here before Monkeytails that don't necessarily know them, Infinite Monkeytails is a great stream. They do a lot of role-playing games. They generally start a couple of hours before us. And so you can double header all your Friday and Saturday nights. It's perfect. You can just enjoy like 6 hours of joyous roleplay. So what more could a person want?
Anyway, not much. That's for sure.
Nah, I think we've got things covered, haven't we? While Lucy's fondling the eggs, Carl is going to put his bag on the bed. Because our inventory works that it's things, how easy it is to grab something, right? So at the top, the things we want most are at the top. So I just want to take the time to check through it, make sure that everything's in the order I'd like it to be, if that's okay.
Yeah. So specifically in combat, you have to roll over the number. If you're trying to get something out for your turn in combat, you have spots 1 to 12, you have to roll over that number, and if you do, then you can continue with the rest of your turn as normal. If not, it takes you your turn to retrieve the item, which includes things such as arrows or bolts for bows and, you know, weapons and basically everything you carry with you. Mm. But out of combat, it's assumed that you can, you know, take a couple of minutes and take your time with it.
Carl is doing it in a way so that Lucy will see what he's got, I guess. He's not being sneaky about it. So he pulls everything out and he openly puts his black clothes. He's got black clothes of the apprentice if he needs them. They always get stashed in the bottom unless I need them. I've got a lantern and oil flask which go next. Some poison vials. I've given you one already, I believe, Lucy, for the night.
Yes, I have some poison.
Just to look after yourself.
Which, just to make sure that that's added somewhere suitable on your inventory as well, Lucy.
Yes, it's poison type 3, apparently.
Yes. The best of all the poisons, no doubt.
I'm sure it's excellent.
Then I'm stashing my knife, then above that the grot goes in, and then I've got some bolts for a crossbow. Then my curved sword is to hand, and then my crossbow itself is to my sort of my chest with a bolt in, ready to go if I need it quickly. So that's my quickest thing to get.
Yeah.
So I'm, cool. I'm tooled up for a party. After hearing Lucy get a bit excited about death and murder at a party, Kyle is making sure he's in that kind of party mode.
And sorry, go on.
No, and then he'll sort of turn to her at that point and say, well, I'm ready. Do you need to get yourself ready, or are you good to party?
I'm genuinely very eager to see the party, so yes, let's go if you're okay.
Absolutely. After you.
Thank you.
Speaking of the party, throughout this, you've been able to hear quite a rhythmic thumping coming from above you, which presumably is the lift, is the roof. I keep saying lift instead of roof. Is the roof directly above the sixth floor. Yeah, and you are free to leave the room if you wish. If you're all sorted, are you taking all of your stuff with you?
I will. Yeah.
Yeah. Same here. I've got enough space in my inventory to make everything portable at the moment.
Wonderful.
Including egg.
Egg, and the most important part of anyone's inventory, really. Yeah. So Carl drops in and motions to the door to Lucy.
I will nod my thanks and head out into the corridor.
Except you won't. So I locked it.
You do, in fact, get to the door, and the door is firmly locked.
Carl allows himself a smile and a wink at you, and then unlocks it, and then opens it, and then offers you up.
Did you store the key somewhere accessible in your pants? You got time. It's all good. As long as it's in your inventory.
Yep,
otherwise.
And if we were in combat at this point, then our friendship has seriously taken a turn.
yeah, for sure. Although the way the lift went, you know, anything could happen.
Yeah. Once the door is opened, I will step out into the corridor and immediately check to see if we still have a brightly coloured knight out there.
Well, the first thing you notice when you open the door is this heavily armoured knight with their lance, their equally brightly coloured, swirling selection of colours, as the same as their armour on their lance. They notice the door open behind them, and they immediately pivot out into the corridor and slam their lance down. They move towards the lift direction, as if to, you know, guard down that way. But they are very much still with you.
Okay. So they've stepped the other way to the way that I'm planning to go, because I'm going to walk to the stairs, obviously.
Yeah, they've turned to face the lift. They've not heard the conversation in the room, but they've heard mention of the roof. So I assume that's where you're going. But they turn to face the lift, and as if to give you access to the other,
okay,
other direction. They seem very on guard.
Well, then in that case, I will step a couple of paces towards the lift and wait until I am joined by Carl.
Carl will lock the door, stash the key, and says, are we taking the stairs up, Lucy, to this party?
It seems to be de rigueur, yes.
Well, then, let us go. Let's go and party. Party hard.
All right.
Wonderful. You proceed down the corridor, followed by the energetically, the overly energetically excitable knight figure who almost bounds along behind you, definitely not being particularly quiet in the movements. And as you head down the corridor, you see off to one side, there's a group of four children that look to be playing some kind of elaborate dice game. And you continue down and you reach the door to the stairs. It's got a little glass window on it. It's quite ornate, equally as chrome as the lift doors, but the handle is carved into some kind of swirling, almost helix around a central chrome tube. And if you open it up, you see the stairwell down and the stairwell going up.
Okay. Yes, I will open the door and peer through and see if I can pick out an appropriate route to the stairs up, please.
Yeah, of course. Carl, are you following, I assume?
Yes, of course.
Carl. Wonderful. You head up the stairs. It's there's a golden handrail that goes up as the stairs box round to go up a floor, basically. On the front facade of each step, there's almost sort of like stick figure drawings acting out scenes. There's one with a few stick figures and some what looks like some bows and some spears and some other stick animals are running away, and there's another one where they're sort of gathered around in a circle, and there's one stick figure in the middle, their arms above their head. There's a selection of these as you go up, presumably just to give you something to look at as you make the long climb either to the roof or to whatever floor your room is on. You eventually box round, and there is there's another door in front of you. It says across it in the same neon type sign that was the garlic bulb that headed into the bar, of forever changing colours, that says roof, and the word roof has a little roof over the top of it in neon signs.
Ah, very clever, yeah. Are we still being followed by our knight?
The knight is indeed with you. They haven't said anything, but they're following. They look enthused.
Well, I enjoy enthusiasm in others. So yes, I will open the door to the roof, if I may.
Yes, you certainly may. Excuse me. The door opens up, and you now know that you were previously in sort of like the little extension of staircases that opens up onto a big flat roof. There's a lot to take in. The first thing you notice is, as you look down, the floor, in fact, appears to be glass. You can't see into the rooms on the sixth floor, though, oddly enough. It appears to be the reception. You look down to a glass floor, and seeing through it, you can see the reception desk with a couple of mandrels behind at this point, sort of talking away to each other. You see a few people milling around. You see the glow of the neon garlic bulb on the bar to the door to the bar, and you see all the thick carpet on the floor, the mismatched artwork, and all the little nooks and chairs with people nestled in. Although there aren't quite as many people as there were when you first arrived, because presumably everyone is now on the way to the feast or at the feast. As you look out across the rooftop, there is a wide selection of many partygoers. You see the group that you first met in the bar gathered around what looks to be a big barbecue grill pit. They're all taken out their cast iron grid, their gridirons off their backs, and laid them across these burning coals that seem to be spitting and sizzling, and the smells of cooked meats and roasted vegetables, some of which you're familiar with, some of which are not, but still smell delicious. You see a stage out directly in front of the doors that doesn't have anybody on it yet, but you know, it looks like there's some movement and some figures around out there. And as you look to the edges of the roof, there appear to be glass panes, again, see-through glass panes coming up from the sides. But beyond those is the weird purple swirlings of clouds that you wouldn't be familiar with necessarily. Carl, possibly, is always the case on this roof. However, at the Feast of the Chili Arch, you can see faint translucent images of similar parties going on what appear to be identical roofs all throughout your field of view. Some of them level up and they go around above you. And as you look up, there's sort of the angle changes. So you look up and you're looking almost directly opposite to another rooftop. It's quite surreal. It's quite overwhelming, to be honest. The amount of different hotels that you can see.
But they all look rooftops. Similar.
They all look identical. Different people, from what you can tell, from the ones that appear to be quite close. They're not. It's not a mirror image of your roof. They are all different parties on each roof, solely by the guests at each.
I'm with you. Okay.
Do you think we're having the best party, Lucy?
By definition.
It's quite spectacular up here, don't you think?
It's remarkable. I've never seen anything quite like it. But then I've seen very little, so maybe this happens everywhere. I mean, perhaps you could let me know if this is just common.
I've certainly not seen anything quite like this before. This is definitely new to me.
So, I have a couple of questions. First of all, where, in fact, is the Golden Barge terminal? I mean, how do you go somewhere from here?
Are you asking Carl, or are you asking me?
I'm asking Carl.
Okay. This is all I double check.
Oh no. Well, it's my, although I am a more travelled man, of course, it is my first time in Troika, coming with you, and so I can only go with what I read on the tourist information. So my guess is almost as good as yours.
We may have lost Ben.
He does struggle with the old Roll 20. While he's away, Carl would like to look around to see if anything. Let me see if I got my skill. He's got awareness. Can I look, as his character is always on the lookout for anything dangerous or dodgy, I guess. Is there anything that stands out to him as something that he would need to be aware of, I guess? Or is everyone like having a good time?
Make an awareness roll for me.
I will make an awareness roll. Oh, that's Ben's little face.
Hey, Ben.
I don't know if that worked or if I'm going to need to do a restart.
Right, you're here.
I've got you.
Physically and emotionally.
Hopefully you can hear us.
Can you hear us? Oh, no. I'm going to roll awareness anyway.
Roll the dice. I'll let him know in chat.
I can't hear you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Right.
Sadly for Carl, his awareness roll was too high, I think. It's an 8, and I need 6 or less on his awareness.
Okay, that doesn't mean you don't get anything. It just means you don't get everything. There's nothing, I mean, there are things that feel out of place and that perhaps would put you off on your home world or your home sphere. Certainly everybody running around with fireworks, setting them up, stacking them in piles, not necessarily aiming them up to the sky, but they're definitely making piles of fireworks sort of around the edges of the hotel, which seems somewhat disconcerting, I suppose, but you assume they do this every, I forget what I said now, 10 to 14 sleeps in Troika, so they're probably quite well practiced.
Okay, I'm hoping you guys can hear me again. Is that okay?
Yes. Have you us?
Thank you for the update on what Carl's doing. Thank you. I do appreciate that.
That's okay.
Yes. So other than the piles of fireworks that people are stocking up and gathering around the sides, I suppose somebody is acting not suspicious, but certainly in a familiar way to Carl. Carl's quite, from what I can tell, is quite low key. Correct me if I'm wrong. Quite nonchalant. I think we've gone with that. And it appears as though the figure that you'd seen downstairs in the bar with the sky blue cape and vestments that was sort of adorned with some kind of gunmetal stitching. They've obviously beaten you up to the roof, presumably taking the stairs without a poorly operated lift. Everyone else is running around, you know, enjoying themselves or chatting to people. They very much look on the lookout for something. In a very nonchalant, Carl-esque way, I suppose.
Like a person after my own heart.
Can I try a second sight, see if I can spot anything magical in the area?
You certainly can. I'm going to have to go to that skill section just so I can get what you would get. But give me a roll against your second sight.
My second sight is a 1, so I roll under skill plus 1, yes?
Yep. 2d6 under your skill plus your second sight.
Okay, that hasn't gone at all well, because I rolled an 11.
Too good, that's the problem.
Okay, so you focus and try to pick out anything magical around you, which is what you would normally get when you're able to. However, Lucy focuses her awareness of magical items. I will let that be up to you when you successfully test it. But in this moment, you can pick it up. But the sheer amount of magic that's coming just from all around you, just in the general, it's a way off, you know, it's in the clouds, it's where the other hotels are, and it's presumably in this gathering of the dimensions of the hotel, is just like coming up with so much background noise that you can't pick anything out. It's quite overwhelming. So you are unaware. Presumably there is some form of magic that is involved in bringing these dimensions and hotels vaguely closer.
Hmm. And people are assembling fireworks at the moment, aren't they?
Yeah, there are people running around with arms of fireworks. They're stocking them up in piles sort of all around the outside of the roof.
Well, that's good. Yeah. Okay. I'm going to wander slowly. I'll nod to Carl in case he wants to join me, but I'm going to wander slowly right to the edge and try and look down over the side of the hotel, you know, at an angle through the glass, so to speak.
Yeah, the glass barrier sort of only comes waist height, so if you want to look over it, you can.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Then I will do that.
Perfect. Perfect. You wander over, and you, looking down on the way over, you sort of get to the edge of the reception area on the way into the hotel. Following that, and as you look over the edge, it's weird. The same way that the degrees seem to shift, and if you look up, you can see the glass wall of another hotel sort of looking down at you from that angle. You can see the long side of a glass wall looking back up at you, and some more hotels and different partygoers running around, and they seem to be doing the same thing as people on your roof are doing there.
Right.
Assembling fireworks and in piles around by the glass, certainly from what you can see at this angle.
All right. Once I've taken a little look at the surrounding area, I'm going to put my back to the glass wall or glass railing and pay a little bit more attention to Sir Brillcream or whoever he is.
Yeah, sure. He has followed you over. He has stood behind you, spear on the ground. When he's sort of stood there resting and almost waiting for you both, I suppose he seems a lot more formal than when he's giddily bounding down the corridors after you. But he is looking around somewhat. He seems quite attentive, and he's almost. He sort of moves over to his hat, his hand onto his tummy, and he rubs his tummy a bit and he's looking around, but no words are passed.
Okay.
He seems quite comfortable.
Carl, I have a strange question.
Go ahead. Strange questions from you.
Which one of us do you think he's following? I mean, if we walk to opposite corners.
Now, this is a very interesting thought there, Lucy. I was don't stare too much because I think they're quite aware of what's going on, but do you recognize that person in the blue from the bar downstairs?
I do.
I want to introduce myself to them, so if you're happy for me to leave you for a while and do that, we could indeed see who the knight is following.
I will meander slowly in kind of the opposite direction then.
Sounds perfect to me. A cunning plan.
My curiosity is about to be sated. See you in a moment.
See you in a minute.
And yes, I will turn my back on whichever direction the guy in the blue with gold uniform stuff is.
Yeah.
And wander slowly just down the side of the building, down the side of the roof. Just glancing around, taking in the scenery, and letting Carl head in the other direction.
Yeah, perfect. So Carl, you head the figure is in fact south. Sort of, if you came up the stairs and the stair building or the door was on the south east corner of the rooftop, the figure is on the south wall, sort of looking out towards the stage on the north wall.
Okay.
With quite a good view. So that is where, Carl, you are heading to meet the figure?
Yes, please.
Wonderful. So Ben, you can go in whichever direction you want. The armored figure sort of pauses for a minute, looks at both of you as if expectant once more. Sees the directions in which you're heading off. Let me just quickly and then follows you, Lucy.
Okay.
Carl, as you approach the figure, they now in fact have their what looks to be a silver handle wrapped in leather sword at their side, and their bow and quiver is on their back. They're dressed in their sky blue vestments with the with the light grey but almost metallic gunmetal type colour stitching in it, and an embroidered symbol on the front of their on the front of their chest.
What's the embroidered symbol again?
The embroidered symbol is I probably should have come up with a graphic for this, but the best way to think of it is a cross, and at the bottom of the cross there's a star at the very bottom, and then on the right as you look at it there's an arrow pointing outwards.
Okay.
We know how important it is to you, Spurs. Whenever there's an outfit that needs describing, we'll always describe it.
But as you approach, they don't make any overly different motions, I suppose. But you do notice their hand sort of slips to their side a little bit. They haven't done anything, but they're still looking out across the rooftop.
Carl sidles up to them, making sure that his hands in a different thing are visibly not clutched to his sword by his side or the crossbow strapped across his chest.
Nonchalant hands.
Nonchalant hands, very nonchalant hands. Sort of tries to sort of look as jovial as he can. It's not a natural expression that he has. And he sort of tries to walk up near the person, and he goes, "Is it male or female? Can we tell what they look like from the hood? Is the hood up over their face? Is it?"
The hood up is up over their face. They look to have quite subtle facial features. Okay. It's not necessarily obvious whether they are male or female. There's no there's no obvious way to tell. But they're quite soft features, curly hair, sort of hanging down across their forehead a little bit. There's a couple of thick curls.
Carl nods and says, well met, friend. I trust you're enjoying the evening.
They look at you and sort of, they don't directly look at you, but they're almost, they turn their head towards you and they're still surveying the room, and they say, yes, but well met. I'm a bit busy though, if you don't mind. I'm sort of on the job.
No, that's okay. I was just wondering how you managed to get up so quickly. We pretty much left you in the bar earlier, and we took the lift, and yet here you are looking well bedded in before we made it. Is there a better way through this building? I don't want to miss out on sort of a more direct route.
Well, I suppose that depends on how many other people want to use the lift at the time. There is only one lift after all. I took the stairs, personally.
That makes sense. That would be my first choice in future. A good idea. Well, thank you. I hope that your work this evening doesn't stop you from enjoying this feast.
They very much make eye contact with you at this point, and they look you up and down, and they say, I recognize your mannerism, or at least I think I do. You seem well armed for a certain trade. Perhaps you could help.
I'm not against offering help to those that need it, if it's for a worthy cause.
Indeed, it is. I don't know how familiar you are with my ilk.
Your elk. You have an elk.
With my elk, I left it in the stables.
No, they don't say that.
with my profession, I'm here. I'm here hunting a demon. A rather nasty one, if you will. It's well, you don't need to know that, but I believe that they frequent the bar. However, on certain occasions, such as the feast, they are known to perform on stage. I was hoping to catch them in the bar before such a public event was held, but alas, they were not to be seen.
Is this a demon that keeps the same shape, or does it go by many different guises?
No. From what my research has told me, it always keeps the same shape. I'm not sure whether you're familiar with a polkageist.
A polkageist?
Yes.
Does that jump into people's bodies and gets them into sort of Eastern European music?
Well, the music is pretty much a given, but they're not one to jump into people's bodies. However, they are an apparition, and as such, they are a demon, and they must be vanquished and destroyed. As is my charge.
One person's charge is another person's vague interest, and you have my vague interest. How will I know them if you wish for help? How do they look?
They sort of they give you a very keen look. They'll be the ghost, probably with an accordion.
Well, the good news is that if we were to kill what we thought was the ghost with an accordion, and it just turned out to be a person with an accordion, then we have also done much good for the world.
Perhaps I misjudged you. My mission is to protect the non-demon entities in these realms.
So what is your plan with this demon? How do you is slaying it a simple thing, or is it to capture the creature?
No, it is in fact a relatively easy thing to accomplish. They must first be encircled by this, and they pull out a pouch from their side and sprinkle some powder from the top of it, and then struck down with a mighty blow from a silver weapon, and they tap the handle of their sword, and such a battle, if going in the right direction, will vanquish them from Troika, and indeed from the other spheres. This is I suppose it should be noted, this is my first assignment, and as such, it is a relatively simple test of my power.
What evil does a polkageist do? What harm does it do to those around it? Can it not live in peace, performing on stages and drinking in bars?
It's a demon, and as such, it must be vanquished. That is my charge. That is the charge of my order. Put their hand on their on the emblem on their chest.
Well, I understand your charge of your order to vanquish things. I understand that. What can I do to help then? I have no silver weapon myself.
And that is rather unfortunate. I I don't have a spare, funnily enough. Normally, if once you are you're fully incorporated into my association, you would certainly have a plethora of silver coated weapons at your disposal. Certainly when going up against much tougher demons than this. Perhaps I don't know. Perhaps there is something that can be found up here. I don't. If not, any magic should be equally as effective.
Magic, you say? I'm not magical myself, but I know of people who make use of magic. Okay. I tell you what, count me in at this moment. I will remain up here during the party, and I will keep an eye out for this polkageist, and in the meantime I will look for something silver or for the aid of someone who is able to use the magic, and I've got your back.
As an aside, try not to we're trying not to make a big thing out of this, you know. Certainly not drawing in any other innocent non-demon types on the roof.
It absolutely suits me. The target and target alone.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
May your strikes be true, and may the demon fall swiftly,
and may the accordion fall silent.
They sort of crack a little smile at the side of their face and nod towards you.
Now, if you'll excuse me, I've got something silver to find.
Indeed.
And Carl sort of nods at them again and turns away to look across the rooftop to see where Lucy is.
Right. Lucy has decided to try speaking to the knight since he's following her. And is going to simply ask him if he is looking forward to the fireworks.
So the knight clearly understands that you are speaking to them. They look around at the piles of fireworks and they nod their head very quickly and vigorously and hold on to their lance in the crook of their arm and start clapping their hands as they do so.
So what is your name, sir?
The clap becomes slower as they sort of cock their head to the side and shrug.
You are incapable of speech, is that correct, sir?
They nod quite enthusiastically for some reason at this, but they're very happy, it seems. But yeah, they nod.
Are you able to communicate using any usable form of sign language?
They nod.
Is there any way you can convey to me why specifically you are following me around?
At this point, they take their lance in both hands and they sort of they take a step back away from you as to not appear aggressive, and they thrust it out in a couple of fighting gestures, and then stand it down by their side and put their hand on their chest, and there's a big clang as they do, and they sort of almost stand to attention.
You are choosing to defend me.
They nod, yeah.
Well, that's good to know. It's going to be hard work to come up with a formal name for you. So, in honor of your chosen weapon, I've decided to call you Lance.
They flourish a couple more times with their lance and stamp it down by the side and again clap very energetically and then almost bow their head to you.
Well, it's very nice to make your acquaintance, Lance. I really only have one more question then, which is you being a person of some degree of nobility, some degree of honor. The fact that you're following me around in order to defend me, is that because there are people here who want to do me harm?
And Lance looks around sort of, I guess worriedly, but then looks back at you and shrugs.
Okay. So it's not as if you've latched onto me because you know I'm in personal danger. It's just you need someone to latch onto to defend them, and I was available. Well, that's excellent. I'm very pleased to hear it. Do you eat and drink, Lance?
Lance nods. Rubs their tummy.
Perhaps we should go and find some refreshments if we can. And I'm going to take a little tour around looking for nibbles.
And they look very excited at this prospect. As Lucy is looking around, this is probably about the same sort of time that Carl is coming back looking for them. But you can indeed see there is a long table next to the barbecue pit area where the group from down in the bar are busy away grilling meats and various other foods. Excuse me. There is a long table that appears to be full of food. Various bottles, silver platters laid out.
Silver, you say? It is.
Oh, I did, didn't I?
It's canon. Make a note.
It is now. But yes, there's a selection of varying types of meats and some vegetables.
Does it appear that this is buffet food for anybody, or is there money changing hats?
No, not that you can see money changing hands. People are freely walking up and, either grabbing some bread and filling it with their selection.
Then in that case, I shall take a bit of food, something that appeals to me, but whatever's good, and I shall nod to young Lance to encourage him to do the same, and I'm going to watch very closely what happens when he tries to eat through his visor.
Perfect. Yeah, there is a wide selection for you to choose from of both drinks and food. Lance is almost overwhelmed by the selection. They are clearly very happy. They head straight over to it's a very flat type, almost pita bread, but it's very lucid in its flexibility. So they hold it with one of their giant hands in their painted armor, and they start filling it with with some meats and some vegetables, and head back over to wherever you are, I suppose. Carl, you are also free to do as you wish at this table.
Carl is walking over to the table and he's looking for anything that might be silver. And he's sort of tapping any metallic tray or implement as he goes past, giving it a rub with sort of his thumb, you know, sort of trying it out to see what's looking good, separating the steel from the other metals, you know.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, Ben, whilst we're on the subject of food, the boiled egg from earlier, you would gain 1d6 stamina points.
Oh, lovely, thank you.
But you have used up one of your ration portions for the day.
Yep, understood. I will roll 1d6 now. And that's in fact a 6. But I can't stock up with 6. I only had 5 down. I was down to 11. So I get back to 16. Is that right?
Yeah, you go up to whatever your maximum is, not yep. beyond. But that sounds right. So okay. From the 2 spells that you used, wasn't it?
That's right. Yeah, I burnt a 4 and a 1. If that makes sense.
Yeah. Perfect. We'll deal with the newly dubbed Lance first, I suppose, before we move on to trying to acquire some silver. Lance has their plate, their breaded plate of meats and vegetables, and they pick up something that looks like a very brightly coloured, multicoloured mushroom, thinly sliced and grilled somewhere, presumably over the coals. Flip up the lid of the helmet, and there is a black void. There is no face behind the helmet. They throw a mushroom in. There's sort of not a metal ting 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 ting, but you know the equivalent sloppy mushroom sound. I suppose there's almost a splat as it hits something. The visor goes back down, and again you can see 2 eyes behind the visor, which you have clearly seen move at points. You know, their head moves very much, but their eyes do go left and right behind the visor.
But when the visor is open, the eyes are gone, just the void.
Yeah, you can't even see the back of the helmet or the inside. It is just black, just blackness. As black as, although black was happy, wasn't it? As black happy and herbal drinks for sadness from last session.
So, yeah. You know,
presumably that's why they're so happy.
Yes, herbal drinks clearly. Are sadness, sure. Yeah. Okay. I'm obviously slightly disconcerted by Void Boy being my night protector. But nonetheless, we press on. I will nibble at a little bit of food and what have you. Not for provision purposes, obviously, just for socializing.
Yeah, that's fine. That's not a problem. You would almost assume that they pick up on your disconcerted nature. They eat quite frequently, but every time they do so, they flip the helmet up, throw it in, and flip it back down again as to not... you could assume as to not expose you to the nothingness behind their visor. Carl, there is a selection of silverware on the table. The table is just as lavishly decorated as the hotel is downstairs. Less thick carpet, but just as much chrome. And you can presume that all of the cutlery and tableware is either some form of glass, gold, silver, or platinum or equivalent precious metal. There are 3-pronged forks. There's a couple of small dishes, almost like bread plates, but they're quite quite thin, and then there are large platters with the cooked meats and various other things on.
Is there anything that looks like a ladle? Something like that, a soup spoon, a big soup spoon, a serving spoon?
There is what appears to be like a meat type stew in a very thick cast iron pot that has a handle sticking out of it.
Carl reaches for a bowl and tears a piece of a bread, a flatbread, and puts it into the side of his bowl, and then goes over to the stew and takes a ladleful and pours it into his bowl, a nice sort of hearty meal, and sort of shakes off the ladle a little bit, and then wants to look around to see if anyone is paying much attention to what he's doing.
Yeah, sure. Are you trying to do this subtly, or are you?
I will be going subtle here. So the idea is, I want to make sure, because not that I can palm it, but I want to be stashing it. I've chosen my weapon, a nice big ladle, and I want it.
Okay. There's a few people along this long stretch of table. I mean, it's quite a long table, but there are a few people. There's one heavily bearded gentleman that is quite close to you, dressed in some black robes. And they seem to be sort of making their way towards the broth or the stew, whatever it is in the pot.
Carl takes the ladle and puts it, dips it back down into the broth, and then he sort of turns to the man with his hands still on the ladle, and he says, "Ah, this is a hearty looking stew, my friend. Would you like a ladleful? I just poured myself one. It smells delicious."
They look at you and say, "Oh, but that's exceedingly kind of you." Young man, yes, I would love. Please fill up my and they hold out what looks like a crusty roll that's sort of been hollowed out. Please fill up.
And Carl does so generously, a lovely serving. The sort of serving you wouldn't get if you were having to pay for it.
Don't skimp on the baby onions either. They might get lots of those in there. They might
of course. And he sort of leans around and sort of stirs around. Tries to sort of carefully get a spoonful that's mostly onions, and tips them on there. Hope that's enough for you, dear man. It looks delicious. It smells lovely, doesn't it?
Perfect. Thank you very much. Thank you. Enjoy the rest of your feast.
You too. Happy feasting.
And they start dipping some other bread in their bread roll, or the filling within, and they wander off. There is nobody immediately around.
I'll quick sort of rub the underside of the ladle across some bread or something to sort of get rid of some of the sauce, and run it across the table, and stealthily and as subtly as possible, run it across the table and then try and stash it, sort of, I don't know, down my trousers or something, I guess. Into
sort of
the inside of my belt, kind of thing.
Yeah, sure. Make a sneak check.
I have sneak. It's why I was being sneaky.
I mean, I'd potentially say you could possibly use disguise if you're trying to disguise it into the rest of your outfit.
I also have disguise.
It's your choice.
We're into my wheelhouse right now.
Yeah, this is clearly your hitting zone, isn't it?
I'm going to go sneak. And that's okay. That is my third five of the night. I've had a few bad ones and three lots of five.
Three fives. Wonderful. Put a little tick next to your successful skill.
When does that go up? Because I've got three there now. What's for sneak?
You can collect as many as you are successful in. What will happen is when you reach... when you have time to reflect on the successful tasks and what you've learned, basically when I feel you've done enough legwork, you can make some rolls to attempt to level up three of them, and then they all get erased and you start again.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
So you can put a tick to next to that one just to mark that you have successfully completed that task, and it is one that is available to potentially level up should your dice play ball when we get that far. And you do indeed secrete the ladle wherever you wish.
Silver ladle, let's write it down. I'm going to secrete it, sort of in the inside of my belt, and I'm going to put it in, so I'll slot it into my inventory where I think that would most likely fit, I guess.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah, perfect.
That would probably go into 5. That's probably similar to the knife, realistically. Okay, so 5, that goes 5, and then everything bumps down 1. Okay.
Wonderful. As you finish doing so, there is a bellowing announcement from sort of all four corners of the rooftop, and as you look up to the stage, there is the gaseous form from the lift with whom you are familiar, at least you have run into, and sounds come out that are reminisce of sort of puffs of air and whiffs of wind, and then almost like a voiceover comes over and says, "We are pleased to announce that the moment has come, and the official feast of the Chili Arch is now in session, and what ensues is." People running to all walls of the rooftops. You can see that some mandrel helpers have been busy lighting torches sort of periodically around the rooftops. And these people are grabbing fireworks. They're lighting the fireworks, and then they are holding them and firing them off in the general direction of other rooftops. The fireworks are firing off, they are exploding into vibrant colours and varying shapes and forms of explosions, some spirals and, think galaxies, there's the odd star, nothing quite Gandalf-esque, there's no dragons swooping around yet, but who knows. And the same thing is happening on other rooftops as well. Whilst you didn't hear any announcements, you can see people scurrying around and fireworks start incoming towards your roof. I would like you both to make a luck roll if you wish to do so. It's never mandatory, but you will reduce your luck by 1 by making the roll.
I will try a luck roll. My current luck is 8. So
I'll do 1 as well. Okay. When can we increase luck again?
When you rest. Let me find the exact rule, but...
So I rolled an 8. I don't know if I need to be equal or under.
Equal or under is...
Okay, that's fine.
Successful.
Then my new exactly. Luck is 7, but I passed lucky that time.
Wonderful.
7 for me, and my new luck is now 7.
Oh, perfect. So you both just pass?
Just passed, yeah.
Carl slightly more. There is a whistle that just comes past Lucy's head as she manages to swiftly just move out the way. It almost grazes the side of your cheek, and Carl is a bit more confident, successful with his dodge attempt, or however you wish to parry or dodge this firework, I suppose, that comes hurtling towards your knees and your feet. And it continues. It goes on for some period of time. At this point, there is also another announcement that comes over that says, and now the feast has been had. The fireworks are ongoing, and the music shall be partaken in. and the gaseous form leaves the stage. At that point, there is a shrill sound of some quite high pitched accordion in a very very pokeresque style of music, that starts coming sort of from all around you, not necessarily from the speakers, but you know, sort of all angles, and then it sort of it pops up from one corner and you see a very white, pale human figure, but with very indistinctive features about them. There is almost a silvery, ironically enough, there's almost a silvery outline to their figure, but it is very much some form of apparition that pops up from the northwest corner of the rooftop through the glass bottomed floor. If you look down, you can't see their feet in the, weirdly, the reception that is below you, not the sixth floor. But they pop up with their accordion and they start playing some music, and there's a very upbeat, and the whole crowd roars and starts cheering. And they have a massive grin on their descriptive face, I suppose. It's, you know, you can tell that they are beaming and there's lots of energy coming from their performance. And then they pop back down, and then they pop back up in the southeast corner, and there's another roar as the crowd, you know, gets into this this performance a little bit more, and then they pop back down, and they pop back up somewhere else, and there's another roar, and this goes on for a few minutes, unless you guys are willing to do anything at this point.
As it's happening, Carl will wander quietly over to Lucy while everyone else is paying attention to the accordioning, the polkering. And he'll sort of quietly nudge her, and he'll quietly whisper, I think I've just agreed to help kind of kill this creature.
Which creature, sorry?
The magnificent polka player.
Ooh. Because he seems to be really popular among these people.
I don't think it's going to go down well.
Is that the chosen method? You want to throw him over the edge of the building?
No, I've got to... well, hopefully, the character in blue, they will do the coup d'etat. But we've got to sprinkle something around him, then bop him on the head with something silver.
Yep, sounds completely rational. Sprinkle something around him. Hit him with the silver.
And he's banished forever. Apparently magic's good with it as well.
Well, I have some available magic that might help, I suppose. Bit gruesome.
How willing are you to make everyone upset?
I'm happy to make everyone on the roof an enemy apart from Lance and yourself.
Okay.
And I'm wondering if Lance, who appears to be a... well, I don't wish to make this sound pejorative in any way. He appears to be, inside his armour, a kind of formless void. So maybe he would be quite suited to demon hunting.
Not a bad call.
I mean, I'm aware that if we go around randomly killing people on the roof during their encores, we'll probably get glared at a bit.
Carl wants to look over at the blue figure to see what their reaction to this whole thing is at this point as we discuss things.
They're very much, they were sort of slouching against the glass wall to the roof and very casually surveying the roof. But at this point, they're very much stood up and upright. their bow is no longer fully across their back, it's sort of over one shoulder. And they're still surveying the roof. They're still very carefully watching as the polkageist pops up from specific points, and you'll see that they're, you know, they're glancing around, will stop, and they'll focus in on that point. And they'll just keep a very cautious eye. But they haven't made any grand gestures as of yet. At this point, I would like you both to make another luck roll for me, though, as fireworks are still going off as the music continues.
Realistically, Carl's not going to. You said you never have to, right? Carl's kind of focused on the polkageist, so he's probably not focusing too much on things pinging around him.
Cool. You can totally choose to. You will fail if you choose not to make the roll, but you can choose to do so.
I have succeeded with a roll of 5, but my luck is now 6.
Okay, perfect. I will. Okay, wonderful. So, Carl, you take a glancing blow in the back. It sort of skips over your shoulder, goes above your head, and if you were to look up, everybody else who is watching that particular firework can see it explodes into a variety of purples and blues and sort of spirals out from the center. But you don't take any damage from such a hit.
Oh.
You're okay.
Oh, wasn't expecting that.
You both of you will have seen that throughout your conversation, certainly talking of fighting and death and honor, that I forgot their name then for a minute.
Lance.
that Lance was very enthusiastically acting out the word, you know, key words that you were saying when it came to honor. They stood up very straight and proud, and demon hunting, they were sort of, you know, they took their lance in both hands and were looking around as if they were hunting something. They seemed very happy to do whatever it is you wish them to do.
Well, given that we have an actual demon to hunt, I think Lance could be a useful ally. Is it really wet of me to suggest that Blue Dude should kind of take the lead, though, in the actual demon hunting?
I think it's only reasonable. It's his their task. It is their guild, is what their very role is.
Then maybe we let Blue Person square off with Demon, and then we pitch in and help.
I think it's very reasonable. After all, we're at a party. Let's enjoy the music until we're no longer allowed to enjoy the music.
Yeah, works for me.
Lance flips up their visor and throws some more meat and tears off a bit of bread and throws that down as well and then flips it back.
Oh, what's that? Lucy, what's that?
That's Lance.
Ah.
Apparently that's just how he is.
Nice to finally see you properly, Lance.
They wave very energetically with the hand that isn't holding their bread and meats. At this point, the polkageist has now popped up in the centre of the stage, and they've fully come up. You can see sort of long flowing a white gown coming off of their form and some legs, but they are playing their music. A group of people have started dancing. It's quite raucous. There are still fireworks going off everywhere. It's very I don't know. Think of late in the day at an Oktoberfest, but with, you know, fireworks being aimed at you. I guess that, you know, there's meat, there's food, everybody's having a drink.
Can I cast a glance at nearby rooftops and see if they also have polkageist types, or if they're doing other things?
Yeah, you can. I think if you're trying to pick out an individual on the stage, I would need a roll of some form from you. Feel free to suggest something. If not, I'll default to awareness, I suppose. Or spot performer.
Yeah, it's,
I'm not sure.
I mean, I don't think I have anything that would really be anything other than a basic skill, I'm afraid.
Okay, cool. Do you wanna suggest a new skill that we could throw out there? You don't have to.
I don't know. Is something like I guess something like pick out individual. Is that plausible?
Yeah, sure, why not? Let's go with it. I'll deal with the consequences later.
Okay. Okay, we will try. And that's a failure. That's a 9.
You can definitely see similar atmospheres. You know, you failed, but you can still pick out what you can pick out. You can still see similar atmospheres going on the rooftops. There are people dancing, different sizes of groups on different rooftops. All the guests are individual to that specific hotel. But it's hard for you to tell whether they do in fact have demons or apparitions or poltergeists on each stage at this current moment.
Right. I mean, so there could be, but we can't tell.
Yeah, hard to tell. Hard to tell. By this point, the figure has made their way up to stand next to you, Carl, and they're not going to face you, but they'll sort of stand next to whichever direction you're facing, and they'll just say, once they're done here, they should return back down to the bar. It's where they, if my research is right, that's where they reside. Will spend most of their time now. That will be a much more secluded space to perform the task.
Probably for the best. You might start a riot if you fulfill your task now. He's very good for a demon.
Demons are not good. They are evil. They must be slain. That is my charge. That is the charge of my group.
Right, certainly slaying right now. This tune's a banger.
They.
Can I, while this is sort of, this conversation is going on, is there something on the buffet table reminiscent of a kebab, for example?
Oh, a bucket of tomatoes, maybe?
There are skewers of chunks of meat, varying in colours and scents and sizes and textures, and there's a plethora of food.
Okay. The skewers in question, little wooden sticks with food on them.
No, these appear to be golden.
Ooh.
Big ring at the bottom, and then a spiraling metal skewer heading up. There is there's also a sort of like a bucket of warm water at the end of the table where people look to have discarded their used.
Okay. Used ones. Well, I shall nibble a skewer of meat, and look faintly disappointed as I throw the skewer in the bucket, but I shall also offer a skewer to Lance in case he's missed that and fancies one, because I'm genuinely curious what he's going to do with that.
Lance nods energetically and takes it from you and lays it down on top of their flatbread.
Oh,
wraps the bread around,
clever.
Pulls the skewer out and passes it back to you.
Clever boy, Lance.
He immediately takes one of the pieces. It's clearly new to them, I suppose, and they flip up their visor and throw it in, and there's a thud as it hits something that you can't see, and then they flip their visor back down.
Oh, we like Lance. Yeah, Lance is growing on me, definitely.
At this point, one of the... one of the male members who you saw down in the bar, who's been doing a lot of the grilling, sidles up and bumps into you, Carl, as they're sort of making their way along the table and helping themselves to some food, and turns and says, "Oh, I'm terribly sorry. I didn't mean to. Are you enjoying the the meat?"
Carl will answer, but because I guess one of his natural habits is that if someone bumps into him or brushes against him, there's a suspicion about him. So he's trying to talk casually while checking pockets and pouches that everything's still there, if that makes sense.
Yeah, sure.
Bill sort of manages a smile and he'll say, it's been absolutely lovely. The stew down there, he sort of holds up the bowl that he's sort of started eating, and he sort of does a visible mouthful. This is lovely. The flavours from it are very rich, very deep.
Mmm. 71 hours that's been cooking for. We obviously finish it off on the flaming grill over there for the high heat, and some good caramelization around the edges, but it's a lot of work has gone into that. A lot of power, as you can, a lot of power and strength and meat has gone into that dish.
You can almost taste the sweat in a good way.
That sort of throws them a bit.
From such a long and well thought out task, surely deserves people that devote their life to chasing down fine food and creating fine meals. Do you belong to a certain group, my friend?
Yes, I do. I'm sorry, my immediate response is to take offence at that, but I am indeed.
I'm new here, friend. I'm sorry, I mean to not offend anyone.
No. I completely understand. It's a fault of ours. I suppose. But my comrades over there, and he gestures to the other two men, and there's a woman standing over by the grill. We're members. We are fellows of the Sublime Society of Beefsteaks. As you can tell by our clothes and the tools we carry with us, I suppose is the best way to identify one of our members.
Carl takes another mouthful of the stew thoughtfully, and he says, "This truly feels like a very important society to have a truly honourable role and an honourable position to provide such wonderful sustenance for everyone here."
It's kind of you to say so, but as are the traditions of our society, it is entirely unnecessary. Words have little power, as I'm sure you know. They can no more build a house or lift a stone than they can sear a good steak. Power is in the actions of one's grilling.
That is true. Is it only through grilling that people can show their power, in your opinion?
There are other ways, but none as straightforward and quick.
There's something very pure about it, I feel.
Indeed. And at this point, one of the other members walks over and they say to them, Jeremiah, quick, we're about to throw on the the next set of ribs. We need your expertise. And as they put their hand on Jeremiah's shoulder, you can both make a luck roll for me if you wish.
Not this time, I think. Running a bit low on luck.
I'll roll this one. You only lose one if you succeed, correct?
No, you lose one regardless whenever you test.
Four, that's plenty. I'm down to six now.
Wonderful. As they put their hand on their shoulder, there is a... It's not an explosion sound, but there is a definite change in air pressure around you. Your eyes almost instinctively close, and when they reopen again, there is no more... Jeremiah is not there. Jeremiah has vanished. There is, however, a pile of Jeremiah's clothes on the floor. And a splattering of red all around, all down the front of whichever side of Lucy was facing Jeremiah is now covered in red. And Lance, who just at that moment had luckily stepped in front of Carl, who is spared from the splattering of red, Lance is equally coated. And the figure, their friend, steps back in shock. Their eyes go wide. They drop some, you know, cuts of prime meat that they're in their hand, and they shout over, "Joe, Jane, quick! It's happened again." And I think that feels like a good point to call it for the evening, unless anyone has any immediate questions.
No, I agree with you. A dramatic conclusion point. Yes, that sounds good to me.
The one thing you would notice as well, Carl, sorry though, for not for passing your luck,
yes,
and having your eyes briefly open for a moment, is that there were no fireworks necessarily that went off in the immediate vicinity.
Interesting.
But that is where we will end.
Oh, so another Jeremiah got
suitably ketchup. Weird session of Troika.
This is a terrible thing to happen to a guy who was making amazing meat.
Yeah, it's a great loss to the society, I feel. Great loss to all of us.
How is it that the guy who makes these amazing slow cooked and then char grilled cuts of meat dies, and the bloody accordion player is still functioning?
He'll get his, don't you worry about that. Oh, Jeremiah.
Oh. Oh, I tell you. Yeah.
But thank you both very much for...
Thank you, it's been a treat as always.
Yeah. Whatever that was.
Just more confusion in the world of Troika.
More chaos, yeah.
Thank you.
Luke, you need to tell us what you're doing on Monday night, because it's a new game, isn't it?
Yes. I am starting a new game. So Monday night, we have if this is your first weekend with us, everyone, this is the Baltic Star Weekend. The Baltic Star Weekend is a four-day weekend, and we do different things. So on a Thursday is generally Luke plays, where I play a video game. Sometimes things happen on Thursday, might be a bit different. Ben throws his hat into the ring from time to time. In his own specialist way, but generally it's playing a video game. Friday is the second day of the Baltic Star Weekend, which is generally Traveller, if we're all here, or something else if one of us is away. Saturday is a range of role-playing games, like Troika tonight, for example. And then during the winter, the Baltic Star Weekend finishes on Sunday nights. But during the summer, due to cricket and things like that, it's very difficult for me to do it on a Sunday, so we do a Monday night. Meditative Monday, it has become. And so in that sense, on Monday night, meditative Monday, I'm going to start a game called Twin Mirrors, which I'm going to actually read a synopsis of it to you. Hang on a sec. Twin Mirrors. It's a PS4 game. Not just PS4. Oh, no. Twin Mirror. There we go. It's a narrative adventure game developed and published by Don't Nod Entertainment, which is Life is Strange. It was released in 2020. Samuel Muley Higgs, formerly known as an investigative journalist, returns to Basswood, West Virginia, in light of his close friend Nick's death. He originally left Basswood due to an article he wrote about the coal mines, which ultimately got them closed, leaving hundreds without jobs and angry townsfolk who despise Sam. During his stay in town, his daughter Nick asks him to check on events leading up to Nick's death, as she finds his activity before he died suspicious. So we're going to do some we're going to investigate a murder.
This is a mystery investigation game.
It is. It's a little bit different. In Bassford, Bassford. I don't know how you'd say it.
Bassford.
Yes.
This sounds a little bit reminiscent of the sort of narrative playthrough games that you've been doing in the past.
It does. It's going to be
very It sounds very cool.
Yes. I'm very interested in it. I mean, I'm already invested in it. I haven't even seen a single frame of it yet.
Exactly. So that's going to be good. So that will run us for the next, I don't know, 5-6 weeks. I don't know, something like that. I'd do an hour and half at most of a night. So, you know, it's not a big investment. And it'd be lovely to have some of you there on Monday nights. Not Ewan, though. We never expect Ewan there because he has a proper job.
Yeah, but he has a job with responsibilities and, you know, actual working hours and things.
It's very good. Yeah, exactly.
Well, yeah, at the very least, I have to wake up.
Yes. So, yes, thank you very much, guys. Thank you very much, everyone in chat. It's been really nice to play this evening through some more of the madness that is Troika. One of the weirdest things I think we've ever done, and all the more delightful because of it.
Exactly. Things will come together eventually. I mean, they'll be equally as weird, but at least it'll it'll bring itself together.
And yes, we will catch you for a little bit of a stream for this new narrative game, new investigative narrative game, on Monday evening. Just before midnight, won't
it?
Yeah,
it's about 11:45 normally. It's quite a late start on it. So. Yeah.
Excellent. So thank you very much, everybody, and we will see you Monday.
Yes.
Well, yeah, thank you. Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night to you.
Ooh.
Yes?
Did you put something on Twitter about a raid on Saturday?
Yeah, but she doesn't seem to be on yet this time. Okay. I thought it was going to fit in, but I think we're a little bit early on it.
Cool. It's, ignore me then.
Spider Queen. She was going to do a new game on their channel. So, but we haven't started yet. So if people are still awake for like another hour or something, go to Diesel. Go to Diesel Shop because there's going to be a cool new game starting in a little.
Right. I will see. I've got a little bit of booze to finish, but probably not that late tonight.
Right. No. Well, thanks, Spez. Thanks, Croy. Thanks, everyone.
Yeah. Thank you. And good night.
Thank you. Good night.
Oh, the lollygaggers are raiding just as we go. Oh, I feel the pressure now. Hey, lollygaggers. How are you doing?
It's lovely to have you with us. I'm afraid we're just winding up.
But thank you, though. We really appreciate the raid. You missed some magical things. Some weird science fiction-y fantasy things. Someone just exploded when someone touched someone on a shoulder, and they just went poof, just like that.
It was bizarre, yes. Yes, we've just played our second session of Troika, and it is as insane as you can possibly imagine, and wonderful.
I don't know how much is actually from the book, and how much is just you and messing with our brains. With
I'm a little bit worried that the insanity is all coming from me.
we got mandrills in a lift. We got through him. What else? We got gas, stinky gas.
Gaseous forms, yeah.
A colourful knight with no face.
Yeah, who follows you around very energetically. Fireworks being fired interdimensionally between other identical hotels with different parties on different rooftops.
A polkageist. I quite like the polkageist.
Yeah, the polka, the accordion playing polkageist is fun.
Oh, you guys, Shy Deezy, hey, the Holy Gags, John, as weepy. Yes, we're Troika's going to become. So we do Traveller most weeks, but we've got other games that we run on Saturdays. And we tend to run them on a 4, 5, 6 week cycle. So we've got Those Dark Places, Orbital Blues, and Troika's joined that. So if you follow our Twitter at all, at Boys Baltic, or you follow this channel, it'll pop up. We'll have another Troika in like 5 weeks or so, something like that. So if you do want to catch it being played, sort of, it's a couple of starts a couple of hours earlier than this, and we'll be in about 5 or 6 weeks maybe. I'd imagine another one maybe that probably fits with our time, does it?
About that. I would think that's about right on average.
So if you are interested in seeing it played, like I say, keep an eye out for us on Twitter or something, and we'll always announce it when we're playing it, so you can catch us for when we actually play it.
And there's always the VOD, of course.
There is, as with
all of our games.
So we've got whatever it's added up to now, about the first 5 hours or so of play into this game, maybe six, that kind of length. Yes. So if you're interested in the game and you haven't seen it played, then you can watch us mess it all up.
Exactly.
Precisely.
Yes, thank you. But now they're all here, I feel I need to bounce a raid on or something. I don't know if you guys, if they were going to, what we've got. Oh, I know what's okay. The MDM. We'll go to them. Ignore the. Oh, there we go. Right, we're going to jump a raid on someone else then, as you guys are here. Don't feel like you have to do or anything, but I feel a bit more pressure on it now. We go to the MDM Studios. They're generally quite nice to us and they do some good stuff. But nice. Thank you, Lollygaggers. We really appreciate the raid, and sorry that
we did. Yes, thank you for joining us, even if it's only so very briefly. We're so pleased to see you. It's very kind of you.
Just do a raid. Right. And yes, we'll see you. We'll see if someone's added us already. Thanks, as Weepy. You'll be up to date on everything we do. Right, here we go. Let's go.